Welcome. This is Cate Crowley, a professor of practice from the program of speech-language pathology at Teachers College, Columbia University in New York City. This is module 3 in this module series, Disorder, Difference, or Gap, a school-age disability evaluation. This module focuses on my direct clinical interactions with Sofie, our 13-year-old, as part of the speech-language evaluation. If you haven't already done so, please download Sofie's speech-language disability evaluation at LEADERSproject.org. In this module series, we will look at video clips of my direct clinical evaluation of Sofie. In this next clip, we get to watch Sofie do some very interesting comparisons of her new town and the city where she grew up.
And you were adopted into your new family 3 years ago?
Yeah.
And how different is it here? I mean, how would you compare life in Springfield? And I'm sure there were some great things about Springfield. Mm-hmm. And life here in East Hampton, and I'm sure there's some great things about East Hampton.
Yeah,
so how would you compare the two?
Well, in Springfield, there was more mixed people. Like, there was more Black and Latinos and Latina people.
Yeah.
And here in East Hampton, it's mostly kind of like just white people.
Uh-huh.
But it's also very quiet. Like, East Hampton's not really a place where, like, there's a whole lot of robberies and like thieves. Like, that's, it's like a peaceful town that like, it's kind of like, it's like a corner of a house. No one would like seem to like go there and look.
Yeah.
Like
what's there.
So, and then in Springfield, there's like, Springfield's kind of like, people don't really like clean as much.
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of like dirty. There's like, not really many like fields. It's mostly just houses and like dirt and like littering all over. It kind of reminds me of New York, but like
living in New York, so.
Yeah, not really.
Let me ask you another question. Is there look about the music and the dance and all that kind of stuff in Springfield versus here? Like the that kind of hip hop culture, that kind of music culture, is that?
Yeah, Springfield has a lot of like hip hop and pop dance moves and music, and people like, I hear music all the time in Springfield. Here, there's not really that much music, but like the music here is like, kind is like still like pop and hip hop, but mostly it's like jazz and like smooth music to me. That's what I think.
So do you like them both, or do you miss the other music?
I miss the other music.
Yeah.
But now I get to listen to like what songs I like.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
so
right. It's not just whatever block you're working on.
Yeah.
You're walking on.
In the language sample we just heard, Sofie makes some sophisticated comparisons of the city where she grew up and the town where she lives with her adoptive parents. We see complex and compound sentences that form the syntactic structures to compare and contrast. One of my favorite evaluation tasks is to do what I call the subway picture. I use it all the time with kids from preschool through high school evaluations. To develop my clinical judgment, I regularly show the subway picture to typically developing students from the same socioeconomic background and same linguistic environment as kids I regularly evaluate, so I know what is typical and what is disordered. Of course, this and most of the materials we use with Sofie are available for free on leadersproject.org. When I use the subway picture, I use the same questions again and again. What happened? How did this happen? Did this ever happen to you? What would you do if this happened to you? I work primarily in New York City, and most kids have had a lot of experiences on the subway. In those rare cases where that is not true, I suggest it might be a train or even an old-fashioned elevator with seats. I elicit information on receptive language, seeing whether they can understand questions that increase in complexity. The questions make them make inferences and problem solve about a rather unusual situation, and students create complex sentences. Sometimes we get a personal narrative out of the questions, which we actually do in this case. Now we listen to Sofie and the subway picture.
I'm going to show you this picture of the subway. Have you ever been on a subway or a train?
Yes.
Where?
In New York. Because we have an apartment there, so we
Oh, that's right. We teach at the same place. Wait, I don't have an apartment there. I have an apartment downtown. So this is an old New York subway. Ready? I'm going to ask you some questions, and I just want you to tell me what you think. Ready? Anything. So what happened?
The guy was trying to get out. He didn't get out fast enough, so then his foot got stuck.
Yes. How did this happen?
There was probably a big crowd, and he couldn't get out in time, and he was probably pushing people, and then finally got out and got caught.
Did this ever happen to you?
Almost.
Almost. Let's hear.
With my arm. So when we were going back to our apartment, our mom was still stuck because her Metro card wasn't working.
Oh, yeah.
Even though she just paid to get it, but it was because she was swiping it the wrong way. So then I was waiting for her, and I was trying to, like, leave the door open for her.
Yeah.
And the door started closing, and then Celia, like, pulled me out.
Mm-hmm.
And my hand, like, almost got stuck. And it, like, I was, like, so freaked out. And I was like,
Now, what would you do if that happened, if your hand got stuck?
If my hand got stuck, so I would probably start yelling.
Uh-huh.
Because I would just be so freaked out.
Yep.
Because I know it will hurt.
What we see is that, first off, she understood every single question. Did this ever happen to you? What would you do if this happened to you? Those I use because they're difficult questions to understand. There is a lot of temporal complexity and verb complexity. In my written evaluation, I put an indented quote with what I asked and what she said. It tells us a lot. Her language is quite complex, especially in the middle. We see a compound complex sentence when Sophie says, "There was probably a big crowd and he didn't get out, so then his foot got stuck." And so then his foot got stuck, serving as her embedded clause. If you look, she uses a temporal clause and also a causal clause in that middle sentence. When I say, "Did this ever happen to you?" she said, "Almost." When we were going back to the apartment, that's your temporal clause. "It happened to my mom." That's your independent clause. "Because she was swiping it the wrong way." That's your causal dependent clause. It is a beautiful sentence we would not expect to emerge so effortlessly from a 13-year-old with a language disability. I also use the language sample from the subway picture to draw attention to the fact that Sophie has acquired all the features of standard American English. For example, she uses modal and conditional tenses. And in the evaluation, I give examples like, "I would probably," and "it would hurt." Standard American English, noun-verb agreement, "we were." Use of copula and auxiliary be forms, "there was," and "she was swiping." And complex sentences, including causation and temporal elements. "When," "so then," "because," and "I know," with a relative clause, "that it would hurt." I'm rarely at the meeting where it gets determined whether a student has a disability and what the student needs. Because of that, I write my evaluations with the intention that the reader reads the evaluation and says, "Oh, I see what that evaluator saw." I put quoted language data in the evaluation with my analysis to create holograms of Sophie's language skills, along with an analysis of findings, as I say at the beginning of that paragraph. Sophie demonstrated age-appropriate ability to follow a line of questions and integrate and organize her thoughts and express them with standard American English grammar. In addition to the SLAM materials, I often use probes with other available assessment materials. I rarely see any student who is only exposed to standard American English and no other languages or dialects, especially in New York City. I find some of the subtests of the CELF to be useful probes for various language skills, although I do not report scores or administer the subtests according to the administrative manual. I normally do not do the CELF-5 Recalling Sentences subtest simply because it is a test of standard American English. For a student only exposed to standard American English and no other dialect, the Recalling Sentences subtest can measure acquisition of syntax. The only reason I gave the recalling sentences subtest to Sofie in this case was to offer a comparison with the prior score-based evaluation that was done 18 months before when she had just been exposed to Standard American English to try to measure how quickly Sofie acquired Standard American English. Remember that Sofie was only recently exposed to Standard American English when she had that evaluation 18 months prior. Remember also, the evaluator concluded that Sofie had a severe language impairment, but what the evaluator really found out primarily was that Sofie had not fully mastered Standard American English. Here again, we had more evidence of difference rather than disorder. Rather than performing in the bottom 1% of the population as she had 18 months before on that earlier speech language evaluation, Sophie's performance now, with a 90% confidence interval, fell between a scale score of 7 to 9 in the low average to average range, indicating that Sofie acquired Standard American English at a very rapid rate. The word classes subtest is one section of the CELF that I like to give in a very non-standard way. I use it to elicit language to look at problem solving, inferences, semantic knowledge, and comparison and contrast. Here's how Sofie did.
So now I'm going to read you some words. And you're going to have to say which two go together and why. Permanent, temporary, faulty, stereo.
Permanent and temporary.
What? How do those go together? Permanent and temporary.
Well, they both have something to do with putting something on. It's just that one stays there longer than the other.
Occupied, relevant, complicated, vacant.
Vacant and occupied.
What?
Just reminds me of a bathroom.
This is how I wrote it up. On the word classes subtest, CELF-5, Sofie demonstrated good problem solving and inferencing skills in word classes. So, this is on my page 12 of the evaluation. For example, she connected smooth rough, search quest, longitude, latitude, enthusiastic, eager, and occupied, vacant. All of the wrong answers were due to her lack of vocabulary, not an inability to make inferences and problem solve. For example, she did not know the words prosperous, memoir, essential, renovate, caricature, parched, arid, or assimilate. We already know that Sofie has weaknesses in vocabulary. This is acknowledged by her mother, her teacher, and Sofie herself. We would expect weaknesses in vocabulary from her socioeconomic background and educational settings from birth through fourth grade. Essentially, if a student has not been exposed to words, that student is not going to know the words and will have weaknesses in vocabulary. We notice that at a certain point in word classes, it becomes a vocabulary test rather than a test of making connections between words. But even with this vocabulary issue, Sofie performed at the average level. I wanted to probe more on vocabulary to see whether she is filling that vocabulary gap over the past 2 years in her current school environment. In sixth grade, her teacher described her as not quite finding her place in the school, but by seventh grade, she had staked her claim, as her teacher said. I thought probing for vocabulary knowledge using the word definition subtest of the CELF might be useful to see whether Sofie was rapidly closing her vocabulary gaps as she so quickly had acquired Standard American English. This subtest looks at semantic knowledge and not simply the ability to label items. In the word definition subtest, we see that she has strong linguistic and problem-solving skills. She also has learned a lot of vocabulary. Here's how I wrote it up. For example, she described treaty as, a treaty is like a contract. A souvenir as something to remember where you were, something precious to someone who got it. A committee as a whole group of people in deciding what to do. A negotiation as trying to work something out. A decade as a very long time. An award as you achieved in something, a reward. You get an award to show your effort. Her mom indicated the family works together building vocabulary with Sofie and her sister at breakfast every morning, and there's a big focus in the school as well.
So Celeste, I want to talk to you about what I found out during the evaluation that really impressed me, actually. I gave her questions to find out about what she knew about words. For example, for a treaty, she said, it's a treaty is like a contract. Souvenir, something to remember where you are, something precious to someone who got it. Committee, a whole group of people in deciding what to do. So I was surprised at the kind of breadth of her semantic knowledge. How do you think that happened?
Well, for treaty, I remember when she learned that in fifth grade for social studies, we had to read it in the textbook, and we talked about what a treaty is, and we had a very long conversation about it at home. And what were the other words?
Souvenir.
Well, we travel a lot, and so like when we went, anytime we go to a place, they get money to buy one souvenir. And we use that word, souvenir.
Something that's very precious to someone makes sense. Well,
right,
because,
right, exactly.
And a committee.
Well, she's on the leadership committee of her school. So the committee meets, and she'll say, I have, you know, the leadership team is meeting, the leadership committee is meeting.
Now, one other thing, she said decade. Now, I couldn't give her points for this because she didn't say 10 years or whatever, but she said a very long time.
Right. So decade, I'm working with the kids all the time on these length words, because there's a lot of words that measure things.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's dozen, decade, century, pint, quart, teaspoon, tablespoon, cup, you know, feet, pounds, hours, minutes. I mean, there's a lot of words. And they came knowing none of those words. And so I play little quiz games, you know, 10 points, how many years in a decade? 10 points, how many years in a century? You know, just not, the points don't add up to anything and nobody keeps track, but it's just a game.
So where do you do that? When do you do that?
In the car, around the breakfast table, you know, just random times.
And have you seen Sophie acquire new words in that way?
Well, definitely all three of them.
Yeah.
And I always start off with the easiest one for the younger child and kind of move up. But one of the things we're kind of worried about with Sophie is that her younger sister, 3 years younger, 11, 12, 13, 14, can often answer the question that Sophie can't.
Mm-hmm.
So like decade and century,
yeah.
She mastered that, and Sophie still sometimes doesn't get it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was impressed by what she knew. It was great to me. I loved award you received, you achieved in something. A reward.
Right.
You get an award to show your effort.
Yeah, we've been working on reward versus award since the kids came to live with us. One of the first things she did when she moved in is she said, I'm putting up all my rewards. And she had these award certificates that she put up on her wall at home in the bedroom. And so, you know, that those words are very similar.
Yeah, they are.
And she confuses them.
Well, not anymore.
Okay.
Or not with me.
Okay.
No, that's good.
Well, it's been a couple of years.
Yeah.
So that's good she got that.
Yeah.
Here again now, in the area of vocabulary acquisition, Sophie has showed that she is closing gaps rapidly. Even if we assume that the CELF-5 is valid, reliable, and free of biases, Sophie's scaled score in the word definition subtest was a 10, which is at the 50th percentile, right at the mean, and a 95% confidence interval from a scaled score of 8 to 12, meaning that everything was well within normal limits. Next, we're going to pull all the pieces together and come to our differential diagnosis: disorder, difference, or gap.